y'all all join with me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your love, your mercy, and your grace. We thank you so much for the many blessings that you have given us. Father, you know that you came from heaven to earth to show us what real love looks like. You taught us that love was about sacrifice, virtue, and service. You taught us that love means putting your life on the line for others. You said there is no greater love than for a man to lay down his life for another. And we thank you that Billy Collins was that kind of man. And we honor him today and thank you for his selfless example of courage and valor. And we ask that you bless and keep the family of Billy Collins and that they will know your presence and special grace at this time. Help them to heal, to move forward in a way that honors his memory. Amen. I just want to thank all of you for coming out today on behalf of the family and myself for supporting Billy Collins. The support that we've gotten from law enforcement since last Friday to yesterday evening with the Sea of Blue, if you wasn't able to witness that, it's probably one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. It's really touching. And I know this is going to be a sad day at the end of this service when Billy gets his last call. Probably not going to be a dry eye in this room. Some tears will be shed. But the family wants everybody to know that this is a celebration of Billy's life today. And I can hear him now. Sheriff, boss, all this ain't necessary. And I reply back to Billy, as buddy, you deserve every bit of this. Sit back, pop you some popcorn, and enjoy the show. Because Billy was not an easy man to blush, but we're going to make him blush today. And I just want to go ahead and get this straight. If there's any young man out in the audience today or watching that has any intentions on dating Danielle or taking her to prom, she got to come through me first. And I believe in honesty in all things is the best policy. So I want to be honest with all of you who are gathered here today to remember and celebrate the life of Billy. Coming up with what to say right here in front of you has been one of the most difficult things I've ever done in my life. I've asked several people's opinions on what they thought would be best to say, what words could bring comfort to a grieving family, a grieving community. And I know that words, no words can eliminate the pain, but sometimes a story can bring a smile. And at times like these, a smile can go a long way to help heal a broken heart. So they said, tell a funny story about Billy. Tell a story of what type of man he was. So right after I was elected sheriff, Billy approached me to offer some much appreciated advice regarding BDCC, where he had served his duty for 11 years at that time. And I said to him, write down your thoughts, put them on paper, and I will look over them. I didn't think about it for several days, been busy with all the new responsibilities that came along with being sheriff. But knowing Billy, I knew he was going to make some good suggestions, several good ideas. What I got was a 5-page report that I know that Billy didn't type, Ms. Teresa. A report on how we could build on the operations there and perhaps be more efficient and more productive for everyone in the facility. And I was so impressed with the details and thoroughness of this report, I was able to implement several of Billy's suggestions. That's the kind of man he was. He was a man of professionalism, of action, a man who loved his job, his community, and a man with the utmost respect for his charge as a peacekeeper and a defender of the people of Webster Parish. Now let me tell you what other kind of man Billy was. Without hesitation, Billy always answered the call to serve and protect and performed his loyal duty for his fellow citizens. It was a duty that he held to the highest esteem. As much as he loved his family and our God, he always honored his loyal duty to protect everyone in this church today. To do his part, to uphold the rule of law, to respond to those in need, even in harm's way. That's exactly what Billy Collins did last Friday when he responded to a call for someone in need. He honored his badge and his oath, and he selflessly performed his duty and made the ultimate sacrifice to prevent another one from taking a life. Billy was a man of courage. Courage is what makes a law enforcement professional or a first responder or military service member to help those in need, even to their own peril. Courage is having confidence in yourself, faith in your training, and to the support of your fellow officer to do whatever is called to save another. Courage, that word is the most fitting for the actions bravely performed by Billy Collins. And although we grieve today for the earthly loss of our family, we also want to celebrate his life of this great man. Mr. Eason, your husband, Lauren and Danielle, your daddy, and Ms. Paula, your son, I hope you can feel the love we have for this special man. Because you may not ever see it on the national news, but this community is extremely thankful that there are law enforcement officers like Billy Collins in the world to keep us safe. They know that what real character is and that true example of courage should be. And let me tell you, it's not what you see on TV today. It's right here in this church. Sergeant Billy Collins, a faithful Christian, a selfless servant to the people of Webster Parish, he will ever be celebrated and remembered for his sacrifice, for his loyalty, for his courage, for his love for a fellow man. Thank you, Billy. We love you, brother.
can only imagine when all I do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Was a man who would always tell me that you're only as good as the effort you put in. And man, can I say that my dad put in 110%. He gave all his effort to his job, his friends, and most of all, his family. I'm not going to get up here and talk about how great he was at work. That's what Mr. Parker and Mr. Hayden are here for. I'm here to talk about the man who raised two strong daughters, who always made sure his family was taken care of, and the man that didn't care what your background was. My dad always would tell me to never judge someone before you know them, because you never know who can change. My dad was the biggest example of this. There were numerous occasions where he would walk up to someone that no one else would have and give them a chance to prove to him that they were worth trying for. My dad was the man who always would tell you that you knew you could count on him no matter what the situation was. He cared so deeply for those he loved. My dad loved cars, and one of his favorite movies was Fast and Furious. And at the end of Fast and Furious 7, Dominic Toretto says, "I used to say I lived my life a quarter mile at a time, and I think that's why we were brothers, because you did too. No matter where you are, whether it's a quarter mile away or halfway across the world, you'll always be with me." My dad lived a quarter mile at a time, and I hope to learn to do the same, and I know that even though he is no longer here, he is always with me. I wish I could convey the amount of love and pride he held for his family and community, but I know you all know how deep it was. My dad was the funniest man I knew, and he always loved to crack jokes. There were times where we'd be in restaurants and he would start making jokes. Well, one of these times we were sitting in Olive Garden and Dad came back from the bathroom and said, "Seven at best." And I remember looking at him so confused, and he said, "The bathroom." And so started the never-ending tradition of raiding restaurant bathrooms. The man was full of jokes, and he always knew how to lighten the mood. When I say that my dad was dedicated to his job, the only way I can convey it is by telling you all the time of my homecoming course presentation. I had told my dad that he was to be there an hour early for the presentation and for pictures. Well, it just so happens that this exact night, my dad was to be patrolling Doyleen for Mr. Hayden. He told me, "I can do 30 minutes, but not an hour. I have tickets to write." I said, "Fine, but you better be changed." Well, sure enough, 30 minutes before my presentation, he shows up in full Doyleen patrol attire. And if I could have gotten a picture of Miss Quirk's face, I would have. You would have thought she saw a ghost, but sure enough, he did all my pictures in Doyleen gear with a full smile on his face. I don't think I would have wanted him any other way. When I look back at those pictures, I not only see the man who loved me as my father, but the man who protected me as a police officer. My dad chose every day to wake up and put on that badge that he wore so proudly. He loved his job and those he worked with. Mr. Hayden and Mr. Parker are just some of those amazing people. Despite these high moments, there were moments in which my dad saw the true consequences of choosing to put on that badge every day. My dad worked with the amazing Miss Sue Lynn. This woman tragically lost her life just a few short years ago. And my dad attended her funeral when she was asked to put the band on his badge in honor of her. My dad never removed that band from his badge, and as I stand here and holding his badge, I don't plan to either. I'll be adding a band to this badge in honor of my father. I know many of you here knew my father and saw the side of him that was serious and work-driven. However, I wish for you to know that despite the serious behavior, he was a man of love and compassion. And the seriousness of demeanor was strictly just his dedication to carry out each job to its full potential. My dad grew connections with many of the students and children of Doyleen. He loved to see the growth of the upcoming generation, and as I stand here, I promise you to continue that dedication to this town. I will continue to uphold his determination to make Doyleen a better place. I know that my dad would not have chosen anyone else to be the people to carry on his legacy than those of the officers who stand before me. My father respected each and every one of you, even if he didn't know you personally. So as I close my speech today, I leave you with this. My dad was a man of honor, dedication, love, and compassion. Not only for his family, his friends, but also his job. He would be so pleased to see the strength of the community during this difficult time. I was recently given this prayer block, and when I was given to me, I was told to read Psalms 34:18, which reads, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit." I can only convey that the Lord has a plan, and my dad would wish for us to carry it out. So remember that the Lord is with us, and my dad is watching down on all of us with such pride and love in his heart. And to my dad, thank you for being my dad, my friend, and most of all, my protector. I love you, Daddy.
Oh, Billy always said, "Boss, I'm gonna make you shake in your boots one day." He's getting his wish today. I want y'all to know I'm not a public speaker, and this is a sad day for me. The night this happened, I was in Wisconsin at my son's wedding. I want to thank all the agencies that responded that night. I can't express my feelings, how I feel, how y'all came to my little town or our little town, and you took care of the people there. I want to notice a couple of deputies tonight. The family requested I do this. Lieutenant Chuck Clark, Sergeant Kobe Barton, you are my brothers. I love you. I will stand with you in any type of thing because I know you will never leave me at no point in time. Deputy Tommy Maddox, brother, they all told me you are the man. And you are. Thank you for all you've done. I want to thank Sheriff Jason Parker for the leadership and role that he showed himself and proved how good of a man he was that night. I stayed on the phone with him as much as I possibly could, and he kept me informed of what was going on. It was a nightmare in my little village. Four and a half years ago, I met Billy. He was working out at the prison. We started talking and our friendship began. I knew he lived there in town, and I really had not ever introduced myself to him. So I asked him, would he be interested in working part-time for the village? Of course, he told me he would. I told him what I had to do about the hiring process and get the approval of the council. And, you know, before I talked to the council, I've done a little checking on it. You know, I talked to some of the people that Billy worked with out at BDCC. And they all said he was a hard-headed man. Heart as big as a room. I knew then we'd be okay because I'm hard-headed too. After I got the approval by the council, I went over to Billy's house and asked if he still wanted to come to work. Billy walks out, no shirt, nothing but his boxer shorts. At that point in time, I knew he was just a good old country boy. Billy told me that he wanted to serve his community. He didn't know a lot of people in town. He was just looking forward to meeting them and protecting them. Billy then asked me if I would talk to his better half. I said, ask him about what? Billy then told me a story. And with Teresa's permission, I'm going to share this story with you this morning. On July 19, 1999, a call went out over the radio in the northern area of Oklahoma. That call was, shots fired, officer down. On that day, Deputy Bernie Roberts, was killed in the line of duty. That was Teresa's grandfather. Because of this tragedy that happened in her family, Teresa was scared of Billy working the streets, and he wanted me to talk to her. I talked to Teresa that day, told her how long I'd been doing this job. Told her I didn't think anything would happen inside the village of Doyle, England, because we were good people. for miles for your radius. Teresa agreed, and she said, if that's going to make him happy, then he can do it. Billy started to work. I started getting phone calls. When Billy started, I told him the main problem we had and complaints in town was speed. So I explained to him, I allow 12 over. You can stop at 12. Right at your discretion if you choose, according to the people's attitude. 15 over, you right. And that's just what he did. The calls were coming in daily about who was this new man in town writing all these tickets. So I finally started asking the people who were calling, were you speeding? And all of them said, yes, sir, was. So the phone calls I got after that, I said, well, if you don't want to meet Billy Collins this way, slow down. But if you speed, he's going to stop you and say hello. Billy called me one day, and he had stopped a little girl. He said, boss, you might be mad at me, but I need to talk to you about this stop. The girl was coming through town. She was doing 57 and a 35. When I pulled in behind her, hit my lights, she would not stop. She then crossed over into the 25 mile an hour zone, and she continued at 57. She finally came to a stop. When I walked up to the car, I said, ma'am, why are you speeding? He said, she looked at me, boss, and started laughing and says, I'm hungry. So he said, boss, you know, I wrote her two tickets. Of course, I said, you know, what for? He said, I wrote one a 57 and a 35 and one 57 and a 25. So I said, Billy, you can't do that, brother. So he said, well, boss, if you would, stick her with the one that's going to cost her the most, because I just didn't like her laughing at me and talking about she was hungry. Billy was doing what I asked. He was loyal, dependable. After a few weeks, he came to the house. He said, thanks for giving me a chance, boss. I'm part of this community now, and I love helping who I can. And after a few weeks, all the calls stopped, and everyone started referring to Billy as Mr. Billy. Billy and I, we weren't on a first name basis. I called him Knucklehead or Mama's Boy. He called me when he worked, he called me Boss. When he wasn't at work, he called me Daddy. Billy was a family man. He loved his mother. And until this tragedy, I'd never met her. But Miss Paula, I knew you. He talked about you all the time. He was always saying, Mama said you need to do this, or Mama said you need to do that. He always talked about how good of a woman you were. He proudly loved and took care of his mother. Billy loved his daughters. Lauren, he always said you were like him, attitude-wise. And since I've had the opportunity to meet you, I can see what he's talking about. Your daddy was very proud of you. Danielle, in your daddy's eyes, you hung the moon. He always referred to you as my baby girl. Your daddy was very proud of you. He also told me you was the smart one of the bunch. Billy always talked about how fantastic you were in your archery and BB gun competitions that you competed in. Teresa, you were his better half, or the woman. These were the words of endearment Billy used when speaking about you. When I called and asked him if he was available for functions going on in town, he'd always say, "Let me check and see before I tell you the woman might have plans." There was never a time you stopped him. You always let him do what he loved to do. Billy loved you very much, and I know this because he told me how special you were to him repeatedly. July the 9th, 2021, a call came over the Webster Parish Sheriff's radio. Shots fired, something none of us that wear these badges want to hear. Officer down. That noise rang out across a little town in North Louisiana and in Webster Parish. Teresa and her family started reliving the nightmare they had once lived before. When I received the call and was told what was happening, I immediately remembered the conversation Teresa, Billy, and I had 4 short years before. The conversation would always haunt me because I said, "Orleans in 1 mile square radius with good people, and I did not think anything bad will ever happen to him." Billy Collins pinned his badges on with dignity, honor, integrity, and pride. Serving the people is what he loved to do. Billy never complained about going out any time, day or night, and helping the people in his community. Did not matter if he knew them or not. His only desire was to help any way that he could. Today, I thank God for the time I have had with Billy Collins. Now, where do we go from here? Myself and all the others that wear this badge and uniform will leave here today, go out to serve and protect, continue to do the very best job we can in our communities because that is what God called us to do. We will wear our badge and uniform proudly in honor and memory of our friend and fallen brother, Sergeant William Earl Collins, Jr., known to his friends and community as Billy. We will look evil in the eye and say, "You will not prevail." We will continue to praise the name of Jesus Christ. He is our Lord and Savior that died on the cross for each and every one of us. Billy, you are my friend, my brother, fellow officer. I love you. We'll miss you, but I will see you again one day.
It's gonna be a long one. Another graveyard shift as he says goodbye to his wife and kids. It's been his life just like his dad's, driving away. I do it for us, and I do it for them, and I ain't gonna buckle under the weight of the band.
Teresa wrote a thank you that she wanted me to read to you today. She said, "Our family would like to say a thank you for all the love and support that we've been given over this last week. The village of Doyleen is the best place to live, and we want all to know that we are so grateful for each and every one of you. We'd like to extend a thank you to all the first responders who risk their lives daily. Thank you to all the first responders who flew into action and responded to this tragedy. And lastly, we'd like to give a very big thank you to Sheriff Jason Parker, Chief Hank Haynes, and Chief Robbie Hayden. Without you three, we would not have made it through all of this. And we're so blessed that you will continue to be in our lives. You three were very special to Billy, and he loved each of you more than you will ever No. You know, there's a passage that I thought about when Chief Robbie was speaking just a moment ago, and it's one that I shared with him just the other day in the car when we went over to the house to see Teresa and the family. When he shared with me the story that he had asked Teresa if Billy could serve, he carried a lot of weight that he was the one responsible for all of this. Chief, I want you to know, and I told you this the other day, I want you to know this, and my prayer is that the Holy Spirit would just burn this in your heart. In Psalm 139, David wrote this. He said, "For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I'll praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lower parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed. And in your book," listen to this, "and in your book were written all of the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them." I want you to understand how much God is involved in all of our lives. Psalm 139 just said that God formed each of us in our mother's womb, that he knit us together before our parents had even seen us, and in his book were written all the days of our life. Every day. Every one of those days. And I want you to remember this, Chief. July the 9th, 2021. I don't like that was Billy's last day. But I do know this, God had that day written in his book before there were one of those days of the 53 years of Billy Collins' life. And so it's not your responsibility. It's not, Teresa, your responsibility. It takes a lot of weight off of us in knowing that God has a perfect plan for our life. But you know, oftentimes when things like this happen, our very first question is why? God, why? Why are we going through this? Why did this happen to Billy? Why then? Here's my prayer, is that God would replace all of those whys with his peace that surpasses all understanding. We're here today to celebrate, really, the life of William Billy Earl Collins, Jr. That life began on October the 9th, 1967, in Shreveport, Louisiana. Billy was preceded in death by his grandparents, Polly White Wilson and Jackie White, and great-grandparents Johnny Calloway, Rose, and E.E. Calloway. But he is survived today by his wife, Teresa, two beautiful daughters, Lauren Collins Curry and husband Roy, and Danielle Collins. He's also survived by his mother, Paula Collins Moore, and his aunts and uncles, Mitzi and Ron Ratliff, Becky and Tommy Turnage, and Teresa Dice. Cousins Michelle Wright, Stephen Wright, and Jennifer Turnage, as well as extended family, loved ones, and friends. I want to share a passage, just two verses with us this afternoon. And to be honest with you, there's not a whole lot that I can say to add to what has already been said about Billy Collins. But you know preachers, they're going to give it a shot anyway, right? Billy Collins was born to be a law enforcement officer. To serve and protect was in his blood. He served and protected his country in the Air Force. He was a veteran of Desert Storm. He served and protected his community for the last 13 years as the Webster Parish Sheriff, as a Webster Parish Sheriff deputy and a Doyleen police officer. I met him at the prison at BDCC. Now, our church at First Baptist Halton used to do a lot of, prior to COVID, a lot of ministry at BDCC, and we were there most every week. And I remember the first time I saw Billy there at BDCC. He was a large man. And when I looked at him, I thought, that guy could break me into pieces if he wanted to. He just carried with him that persona of he could hurt you if he wanted. But the more you got to know him, you realize that he was a lot like an M&M, right? He had that hard candy shell, but on the inside, right? On the inside, it was sweet. He had, just like Chief said, he had a heart as big as this room. But most importantly, he served and protected his family. For the past 19 years, Teresa, he has loved you and cared for you. He was a girl dad. My wife and I have three boys. We couldn't make a girl, but Billy was a girl dad. And when we sat over at the house the other day, they shared with me that Billy played Pretty Pretty Princess with his girl. Now look, I know y'all, a lot of y'all who knew him in law enforcement could not imagine him getting dressed up and letting his girls do that and play Pretty Pretty Princess with him. But that's what dad girls do. His girls were everything for him. Lauren and Danielle, he protected you, mostly from boys, which has already been said. In fact, he has made it nearly impossible for dating. With his background checks and interrogation tactics, he has kept boys at bay. It took a long time for he to even like you, Roy, when Lauren started bringing you around. But he finally fell in love with you and was so proud of you and the direction that you chose, and you had a bond with him as you served in law enforcement as well. He was a jokester. In fact, the family refers to him as a 315-pound ninja.
He can move throughout the house in ways where you wouldn't even be able to hear him. And he showed up in rooms and nobody knew he was there. He constantly was pulling jokes and pranks on people. He was a mama's boy. Lived right across the street from his mama. I can't pick on him too bad because I was a mama's boy too. There's something special, a special bond between a boy and his mom. But Miss Paula, you raised an incredible man. An incredible man who loved you and took care of you. Some of y'all, most of y'all know he was a huge football fan. If the Tigers or the Saints were playing, nothing else mattered. I've talked about how he served and protected. He served this country, his community. He protected those who were in his community, protected his family so well. But he could protect that remote control better than anyone. If the Tigers were on or the Saints were on, you were not going to be in control of that. In fact, when Danielle was born in the labor and delivery room, the TV was on because the Saints were playing, and the doctor made him turn the game off when Danielle was delivered. Huge football fan. Serving and protecting came natural to him. As a 3-year-old boy, I'm telling you, we sat in that living room and laughed so hard the other day. His mama, Miss Paula, started sharing stories about him when he was a little boy. And when he was a 3-year-old boy, Billy woke up early one morning and was planning to serve his family fried bologna. But he nearly burned the house down because he was frying it in the wrapper. Then at 5 years old, he woke up early to protect his family from a cheesecake that his mother had made the night before. And he was sitting in the living room floor eating the cheesecake with both hands when he was caught. And then at 7 years old, he was protecting the family again from those complex carbohydrates he kept hidden in his dresser drawer in his bedroom. He has been protecting and serving his family since he was 3 years old. When they started telling me those stories, I said, "Miss Paula, I see a theme here. You should have fed that boy, right?" But I want you to know, if you knew Billy Collins, you knew he made up for lost time, right? He was an incredible guy. He served. He protected. But I want you to know this. There's some people in this life who teach us how to live. We look at their life, and they teach us how to go throughout the circumstances of life, the difficult times of life. They teach us how to live. And then there's those rare people that come along that they not only teach us how to live, but they teach us how to die. And I want you to know something. Deputy Billy Collins taught us how to die. He served and protected in his very last moment on this earth. In his attempt to shield a lady, he was wounded fatally. And he served and protected till his very last breath. I want you to know something. Funerals are not for those who are gone. Funerals are for those who are left. Preachers don't have the ability to preach anybody into heaven. There's nothing that I can say that can preach Billy into heaven. In fact, I can tell you this. Billy's not in heaven today because he was a good father, though he was a great daddy. But Billy Collins isn't in heaven today because he was a wonderful husband, but he was that as well. He's not in heaven today because he was a great law enforcement officer, but yet he was a great law enforcement officer. Billy Collins is in heaven today not because of anything that Billy Collins did. Billy Collins is in heaven today because what Jesus Christ has done for him. You see, you and I will try to get to heaven a lot of ways by being good, but the only way to heaven is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we'll be honest, right? That Billy's relationship with Jesus was a private relationship, but it was a deep faith that he had. He trusted in Christ, and he lived with Christ in his life. Now, what's amazing about that is no preacher can preach you into heaven. That's something that you have to do by trusting Jesus. I saw a bumper sticker one time that said, "Live your life in such a way that the pastor doesn't have to lie at your funeral." Right? But Billy Collins lived that life. He wasn't perfect, but he was forgiven. There's two verses in the book of John that I want to share with you really briefly this afternoon. And the Lord Jesus makes this statement. And he literally is showing himself to be one who came to this world to do two things: to serve and to protect. But listen to what he says. It's in John chapter 15, verse 12. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." You see, that's service. You and I can't serve someone else without loving them. Jesus said, "Here's my commandment. You love others just as I have loved you." And Jesus demonstrated his love to all of us. He served. But then he says in verse 13, listen to this: "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends." That's protecting. Jesus said, "You love others as I've loved you." That's serving. And no greater love has anyone than this, that he'll lay down his life for his friend. Jesus was telling them in John chapter 15 that one day I'm going to lay my life down for you in order to protect you. You say, "Well, protect me. Protect me from what?" Jesus came into this world to die for us, to protect you from you. To protect you from your sin. To protect you from the curse of sin in your life. He came as the perfect sacrifice to die in your place. Now listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says that all of us have sinned. Do you know who that includes? Every one of us. The best of us in this room has blown it. The best of us in this room, when we lay our life in front of the Lord Jesus, we fall miserably short. All of us have sinned. But listen to what else the Bible says. The Bible says he demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He laid his life down for us, demonstrating how much he loved us. And then the Bible says this, that the wages of sin is death. That what you deserve for being a sinner, what I deserve for being a sinner is death. But there's a gift. Well, a gift is so much different than a wage, right? A wage is something that I earn. A wage is something that I have worked for. And so what I earn for being a sinner is to die for all of eternity. But God says, "I'm offering you a gift." A gift's different than a wage. A gift you don't earn. A gift is given to you because somebody loves you. That's what it says. The gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So eternal life comes through Jesus, not you, not me, not Billy. We can't earn our salvation. We're offered that salvation. Now, if all of that is true, and it is, then how do we get that? How do we receive that gift? How do we know that when our day, that last day that's written in the book, that's our last day, how do we know where we'll spend eternity? Well, the only way to know that is to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it begs the question for us this morning: how do I begin that relationship with Jesus? Listen to this verse. It says, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You know what that means? A lot of badges in here. You need backup when it comes to salvation. Jesus is the only one to call on for your salvation. "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Listen, I'm grateful Billy called upon the name of the Lord. You see, because of that, it makes today bearable. Because of that, we can walk away with our sanity because we know where he is. about you. Has there been a time in your life that you've said yes to Jesus Christ? Has there been a time in your life that you've asked for that gift, repenting of your sins, walking away from your life, and surrendering your life to Jesus Christ? You know, we've talked a lot about this since Friday. The family said it. I know good is going to come out of this. I know that God's going to do something good even out of this darkness. And you know what I believe in? I believe the good that God may do out of this is going to be in your life. I believe that there's some people here today who've never placed faith in Jesus Christ. And I believe today God wants to redeem you and save you. And so this is what I want us to do. This is how I want to end my time this morning. I want us to do this. I want us to bow our heads together. Heads are bowed across the room. I want you to think about those verses that I just told you. All of us have sinned. God demonstrated His love towards us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. You deserve, I deserve death, but we're offered the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Bible tells us that no one comes to the Father unless they're drawn by His Spirit. Maybe today, in this moment, God's drawing you by His Spirit. I remember what that was like in my life. It felt as though somebody was on the inside of me, pulling at me. And maybe today God's drawing you and pulling you to Himself. What do you do with that? Well, you remember that verse, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." All you have to do is ask Him. Walk away from your life, repent of your sins, and receive that gift of eternal life. In fact, this morning, I would love to help you do that and ask Christ to come into your life this morning. So maybe just in the quietness of your heart that you would ask and pray for that. Maybe you would pray a prayer that was something like this. I'll tell you, the words of this prayer are not magical. They don't save you. It's just a way to communicate that you need Him. Maybe in the quietness of your heart this morning, you'd pray something like this. God, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've blown it. I know Christ has died for me. And Father, I accept Jesus and His sacrifice for my sin. God, come to live inside of me. Save me today. And I ask this in Jesus' precious name. And every head still bowed across this room. Every eye still closed. Listen, nobody's looking but me, but I wonder if you'd be honest today. And I promise nobody's going to come to you, but I wonder if you'd be honest today and say, you know what, Pastor, I prayed with you, and I said yes to Jesus, and I received Christ as my Savior this morning. And you just slip your hand up where I could see you all across this room. Anybody like that? Amen. Praise the Lord. Four right there in the center. Anybody like that? Hold it up real high where I can see it. This is the good that comes out of what's bad, right? Anybody else? Pastor, I prayed that prayer with you, and I gave my life to Jesus Christ today. Amen. Amen. Father, thank you for this time. God, thank you for Billy Collins. God, thank you for the life that he lived. God, thank you for the love that he gave. God, thank you for the legacy that he leaves. Father, I pray for this family. God, that you would give comfort as only you can. God, that your Holy Spirit would minister to them. And God, you would send mercy fresh every morning into their lives. God, I pray for Teresa. That God, as she walks through this new normal, God, that you would comfort her and that you would put people around her to walk with her. God, for Lauren and Danielle, I pray the same. For Miss Paula, God, I pray that you would cover them with your Holy Spirit. And God, you would be real, maybe more real than you have ever been in their life. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
question. So all units, prepare, last call. Webster SO, Dolling 2. Webster SO, Dolling 2. Webster SO, Officer William Earl Collins Jr. Officer Collins, we thank you for your dedication, loyalty, and service to the citizens of Dolling, Louisiana, and Webster Parish. You made the people you serve and your family proud. You have influenced many with your compassion, respect for all people, and service in law enforcement. We will remember you. Your sacrifice will never be forgotten. Webster SO to all units, Dolling 2, Officer Billy Collins is 10-7. End of watch, July 9, 2021. Rest easy, brother. We have the watch from here.
On behalf of the Collins family, I would like to thank everyone today for coming out for the celebration of Sergeant Collins' life. Family says thank you to everyone, and special thanks to our law enforcement agencies. At this time, we would love all law enforcement, would you please rise? We will be having a pass-by. It will be with our Webster Sheriff's Department and Dolling Police Department only. As they exit the building, would all of our law enforcement then be dismissed? Thank you. If our guests will remain seated, the family remains seated, and we will pay our last respects. Thank you.